Test, test. Alrighty. Well, good evening, everyone. Are we on back there, Cameron? Already broadcasting to the entire world. Excellent, excellent. Well, good evening, everyone who's out there and those who are able to join us here in person. There are still enough pews for everyone to get probably five of their own. But so anytime, we're glad to have the ability to offer being here in person. Plenty of space here. And of course, we know that many are still at home, still staying safe, hopefully staying healthy. And we're glad we can continue to project out there and everywhere. I am in tonight for Mark. Pastor Mark has gone to Arizona to be with his mother as she just had heart surgery. The update he sent to me is that she came through the surgery okay, and she is in ICU, which is what they usually do for that kind of surgery, so she's doing well. And an answer to prayer and a blessing was that he was allowed to visit her after the surgery. You know how there's sometimes different rules and regulations about visiting in hospitals, but he was able to visit her after the surgery, and he was able to visit her this morning as well. And so he is over in Arizona. Our prayers continue to go over for him and for his mother through the surgery. But so far, a good report that we've heard from there. And we're continuing on here at the church. Sunday services, we continue to see more faces. We're glad to continue to go through our series. Mark will be out for the next two Sundays, so I'll be preaching for next two Sundays. And I'll be starting this Sunday. I'll do an introduction to Philippians, and each time I get an opportunity, we'll be going through a series in Philippians in the future on Sundays. So sometimes I have a couple Sundays back-to-back, or I have three or four Sundays back-to-back, probably in the summertime. And so that's something to look forward to on Sundays. We've been glad to see everyone who could make it from there. And just a reminder of some other studies that are going on. The Thursday morning ladies is tomorrow. And I think those things are updated in the bulletin, updated online. Or if anyone ever has a question about those groups, go ahead and give a call to the office or put something up on Facebook. And I'm sure if someone sees it or when we see it, we'll update you on any Bible studies you have questions about. And next Wednesday, Mark will be back, and he'll be doing a lesson on spiritual warfare. I saw him, one of the main books he took when he was going to see his mom was a giant book on spiritual warfare. I think it was like 400 or 500 pages long. So he should have a lot of great teaching on spiritual warfare when he returns next week. Tonight, we're going to be in 1 Corinthians, and the title of our message is Gospel Unity. So if you want to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, the very first chapter in Corinthians. And just a note, as we go through this, I'll periodically ask if anyone has questions that they want to ask. So if you're here in person for questions, or if you're on the feed, just give a few seconds, or even write your question as we go along. And usually at the end of each point, I will give a time for questions and try to address those questions if any of them come up. So go ahead and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and then I'll pray in just a moment. All right, let's pray as we start our study. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for everything that you have given us, everything that's in our lives, that we can even be here right now studying your word, studying your truth, that we get to dig in, we get to see your wisdom, we get to learn the lessons that you want to teach us here. And as we look especially at this message tonight, one that is very important for us individually, as a church, and even for our society, help us to learn about true unity in Christ. And we know that it takes the Holy Spirit to help us to understand your truth and to impress the truth on our hearts. So we thank you, God, for this time. In Jesus' name, amen. So as we go to 1 Corinthians 1, Paul is writing to a very troubled church here in Corinth. And I think For some reason, the book of Corinthians has been on my heart as well as Pastor Mark's heart. I know he did a devotional out of it recently, and then not too long ago we did 1 Corinthians 13, the great love chapter. There's so much amazing teaching all through the book of Corinthians. And one thing that we see in our society a lot today, especially, is division. We see a lot of division, and we see a lot of people clamoring for some type of ideology or some way to make unity between people. So we see all of these divisions. They seem like they're innumerable or insurmountable, and you can just go down the list of things we see all the time. Differences in politics or ethnicity or culture or language or religion or social status, economics, gender, or wherever someone came from. And so our society is struggling through this, obviously answering this question and addressing this issue in a very bad way. Usually, the answer I see that they come up with is favoritism, right? They say, well, one group seemed to do better for some period of time. Now let's put them down and put some other group up. So they can't answer the question of unity. They only have more division among them. Does the Bible have an answer for unity? What is the message from Scripture about uniting people, especially uniting Christians? That's the message of the gospel. And in fact, there is unity in the gospel. And so Paul wrote on unity many times in his writings. There's many sections, especially in Ephesians 2, 1 Corinthians 12, Romans 12, he often spoke about the body of Christ. He would explain how everyone was individually a member of one another. There were certain gifts. There were certain, those gifts were abilities to edify the church, and there should be unity in the body of Christ. I think this came from Acts 9. If you remember when Paul was saved on the road to Damascus, the first thing that Jesus said to him was, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And this had a theological impact on Paul when he was persecuting the believers in Christ, right? He was taking them to jail. He was agreeing that they should be punished. Even with Stephen, he agreed that he could be put to death. And so as he thought about this, he realized that every single Christian, when we are saved, when a Christian is saved, becomes a part of the body of Christ. And all through Paul's writings, as we'll see tonight as well, one of his favorite phrases is, in Christ. So he'll say, the salvation is in Christ, the spiritual blessings are in Christ, you are in Christ, your faith is in Christ, because everyone who is saved is united to Christ and is therefore united to one another. The Corinthian church had many divisions in it. It was a church that was struggling to separate itself from the world, and so there were factions and divisions dividing over all kinds of preferences, all kinds of different goals in the church, and Paul will explain this in verses 10 through 17. The first thing we see is that gospel unity is in crisis. Gospel unity in crisis in verses 10 through 17. Verse 10. Now I urge you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all agree that there be no divisions among you, but that you be made complete in the same mind and in the same judgment. For I have been informed concerning you, my brothers and sisters, by Chloe's people, that there are quarrels among you. Now I mean this, that each one of you is saying, I am with Paul, or I am with Apollos, or I am with Cephas, or I am with Christ. Has Christ been divided? Paul was not crucified for you, was he? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I am thankful that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one would say you were baptized in my name. But I did baptize the household of Stephanas, and also beyond that, I do not know if I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with cleverness of speech, so that the cross of Christ would be made of no effect. And so Paul begins here, and he starts pleading with them that they would be unified with all the divisions that were going on. And even as we continue to notice words through the passage, it says he pleads with them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So his appeal is already appealing to them. They have believed in Jesus. They are Christians now. On the reputation, on the basis of the Lord Jesus Christ, that they should be unified because they are fellow believers with one another. And he says there that they would agree, and that word also means to say or speak the same thing. And so they were divided. They were not on the same page. They were not saying the same things. This could mean that they had different beliefs about even the essential doctrines of Christianity. Was it God or the gospel or sin or Jesus Christ or the Holy Spirit or different things? And even the idea, if you asked 10 of them, maybe you would get 10 different answers on the different doctrines that were in the church. And so Paul is saying these divisions should not be happening, that they need to come to agreement, they need to start saying the same thing. Of course, the basis of that would be teaching from God's word, that they were in agreement about the teachings of Christ and the teachings of the Bible and of truth. And he uses this word here, divisions. So he says, agree that there be no divisions among you. And he uses these really powerful words. And when I say them, even this one in Greek, we can tell what it means. This word in Greek is schismata, schismata. And so the word you can hear there is a schism, some kind of division or dissension, a splitting apart because there's conflict over different goals, different objectives, different preferences and desires that they wanted. So there was a schism in the church because of the different things that they were seeing, even the different things that they were teaching. And then he says, instead of this, there shouldn't be these divisions, but instead be made complete or joined together. And this is another really great word. The word actually means to mend or to restore or to put something in order. And this would be a word that was used if there was a broken bone, that you would set the bone and then it would be healed, it would come back together. And this is the picture. A bone breaks, there's a serious injury, it needs to be set, it needs to be put back in order for it to heal. And this is what Paul is telling them. Agree with one another, join back together again. Many times when he teaches on unity, he says these same phrases. He says, be of the same mind, which he says here. So their minds are not on the same page. They're thinking different things. They're not understanding each other the way that they should be understanding each other. It says that they should have the same judgment. And so we can picture them when there was a different decision in the church or something like that. Everyone was coming with different judgments, with different ideas, with different preferences, because they weren't making decisions or they weren't informed by the truth of God. And so that's why there were so many different judgments and decisions that were contradictory, or just one person over here saying one thing and another person over there saying another thing. And then in verse 11, he says, I've been informed concerning you that there are quarrels among you, and by Chloe's people. So a group of people there had gotten word back to Paul. There are these divisions that are happening in the church. The church had become a battleground with these different factions going every which way. And even here is a very descriptive word. There's quarrels in the church. So these are angry arguments, contention, strife, discord. They're really fighting amongst one another. So this is absolutely not the picture of a church where we're saying, oh, there should be love and worship and building each other up and evangelism. Instead, the opposite was happening. They were all divided, one from another, angry arguments and things like that. Their witness of unity was being covered. It was very dark in the world. You couldn't see unity there. In verse 12, Paul mentions what their primary problem is. They have been dividing into the factions of different leaders in the church. He says, each one of you is saying, I am of Paul, or I am of Apollos, I am of Cephas, or I am of Christ. So they made these different parties, these different groups, these different factions over the personalities that were in the church. So these were personality cults. Now, of course, being of Paul, these would be those who maybe they heard the gospel from Paul and they were saved by him, or maybe they were baptized by him, or maybe he was just their favorite teacher. Apollos is called an eloquent Jewish man in Acts 18. And so many wanted to follow him. It says he was mighty in the scriptures. He was contending with the Jewish people who were not believing. And so they prized how well he could speak and how well he knew the word. It also mentions Cephas, and that is just another name for Peter. And so Peter, in the book of Acts was seen primarily as the apostle to the Jews, but he also witnessed to the Gentiles as well. But he was also powerful in speech, powerful in miracles, and so some said, oh, we primarily follow Cephas. And then there were those who said, I am of Christ, and likely this was a negative statement, meaning that maybe they had some pride, said, well, we just follow Christ. You know, they were ignoring the apostles, or they were even turning away from teachers in the church, thinking, we don't need anyone to teach us, we'll just go off of what we have, and we follow Christ. And so they were all divided this way. And remember, these rivalries and these divisions, they were not what these leaders wanted. It's not what Paul or Cephas or Apollos and, of course, Christ would want in the church. We want unity. And so the people were dividing this way of their own accord. And so Paul asks some rhetorical questions in verse 13. And he wants unity out of this. He wants the Corinthians to be thinking about what they are doing amongst themselves in their division. Verse 13, he says, has Christ been divided? Paul was not crucified for you, was he? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? And of course, the answer to all of these questions is no. First, Christ is not divided. There is unity in Christ, which we will hit on many times through this passage. But for anyone out there, the message is, if you believe, if you turn from your sins, if you trust in Christ, then you are saved. Then you are in Christ. Then you are a part of the body of Christ. So Paul is thinking here, as we mentioned before, one of his favorite phrases, in Christ, he talks about the body of Christ. The picture he sees of this church is that they seem like a body that's separating one part from another. So the body of Christ is dividing. So even if we thought of like someone's body being dismembered, right, it's a shocking thing. So he thinks you are all united in Christ. Christ is absolutely not divided, and that's why he is shocked by this and trying to get them to see the same picture that he sees in their division. Paul was not crucified for you, so he asked them, the very center of the gospel, was Paul crucified for them? No. Was Cephas or Apollos or someone else? No, it was Jesus Christ. Jesus went to the cross to pay for sins. Jesus suffered the penalty for sins. And that's the basis of our salvation, the basis of the Corinthian salvation. So he's trying to get them to realize that is the message that unites them, the cross of Christ. And we'll see that more in the next section. And then his last question, which he elaborates more right below this, or were you baptized in the name of Paul? And of course, the answer is no. They were baptized in the same name which Jesus said for them to be baptized in. Anyone who's here, remember the name Jesus said right at the end of Matthew? What were they supposed to be baptized in? The name of what? Right. So in the Great Commission, Jesus said the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So the name of the triune God was who every one of them would have been baptized in. They weren't going down into the water, and they weren't saying, oh, now you're baptized in the name of Paul or Peter or somebody else. No, it was always in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So they were supposed to realize that they were united because they were joined with God. They were joined with Christ symbolically in their baptism. And he goes on to explain the baptism more. In verse 14, I thank God I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one would say you were baptized in my name. 16, I did baptize the household of Stephanas, and beyond that I do not know whether I baptized any other. And I think the point that Paul is making here is what he says right below this. Actually, let me read that first line. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. So what he mentions there is that they were even getting confused, that when someone was baptized, they would remember who baptized them. Oh, was it Paul or Peter? Or they thought if they could get the greatest apostle to baptize them, then somehow that was a better baptism, or that they would be bragging about that. But Paul says Christ did not send him primarily to baptize. Certainly is commanded by Christ. It is very important. Baptism is the symbol of a regenerated life. So going down into the water shows death and sins, and then the water symbolically washing away sins, and rising up is new spiritual life, looking forward to new resurrection life, just like the resurrection life of Jesus. And so it's very important, but Paul is making the point. His main mission was to preach the gospel, to preach the cross of Christ. And he even says, there are even some who he baptized that he forgot who they were. I think he's just making the point that he wasn't making a list of everyone he baptized and saying, oh, look at all the followers I have now, or look at all of those I baptized in my name. No, he went, he baptized, he probably baptized innumerable people over time, but they shouldn't be bragging that, oh, I was baptized by Paul. No, they should be saying they were baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and that's what's supposed to bring unity. But they were dividing over some type of pride in baptism. And so he says in the last verse there, in verse 17, he clarifies for them, he says, Christ is not somebody baptized but to preach the gospel, not in cleverness of speech, so that the cross of Christ would be made void. And so he says, he's not being sidetracked by these side issues, these divisions in the church over whatever leader they wanted to follow. And of course, later in the letter, he talks about how they were prideful towards one another, how they were inconsiderate of one another. There are a lot of issues between, you could say, Jewish sentiments and Gentile sentiments, so they just weren't considering how to be united in Christ because of different backgrounds and different preferences in the church. And so he preaches the gospel. The gospel is unity. He mentions, as we'll see a lot in the next section as well, he didn't come in cleverness of speech or with these amazing words to try to persuade them so the cross of Christ would not be made void. Now, Paul will explain this a lot more in the next section, but he's just saying he simply proclaimed the gospel. He wanted all the glory to be to God. It wasn't his own abilities. It wasn't some flowery rhetoric, but it was the message itself that was going to save. And so this is unity that is in crisis, division over doctrine, could be division over personality, different leaders, whatever the issue is, and we need to be aware of these divisions happening as well. But Paul gives the answer in verse 17. It's in the gospel that we have our unity, and he'll go on to show us what he means by that in the verses following. Are there any questions up to this point? Each point we'll stop for a moment of questions, or if there's any questions on the feed or anything. Yeah, go ahead and write them down or post them, and we'll get to those in between the points here. Anything on the feed, Cameron? Okay. Let me take a quick drink of water and we'll go on. All right. So now there's gospel unity in the cross. Paul is going to continue on and to make his point, where is unity going to be found? This church was dividing amongst each other, and again, as we mentioned, whatever divisions are happening, even in the world, the gospel is the answer to that. And so he elaborates on gospel unity in the cross in verses 18 through 25. He says, "For the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the understanding of those who have understanding I will confound. Where is the wise person? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has God not made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not come to know God, God was pleased through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For indeed, Jews ask for signs and Greeks search for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, to Jews a stumbling block and to Gentiles foolishness, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than mankind, and the weakness of God is stronger than mankind." Paul begins and says the message of the cross, and of course, as we mentioned, that is the good news, the gospel message for those who are being saved. And even the image of the cross there, whereas the Bible says Jesus was crucified there. He was nailed there. He shed his blood. He died on the cross. And that's the picture of his sacrifice. And then, of course, our sins being put onto him, all in the act of the cross. And so he says the word of the cross, and he uses this word right after this. He says, is foolishness to those who are perishing, But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Now, in this idea of foolishness, just remember, he was preaching in the ancient world 2,000 years ago, and this message would be sound like foolishness to them, especially back in that time. I think today, you know, we're so familiar with the cross. You know, we have maybe jewelry of the cross or crosses hanging or on the church. But back then, the cross was a symbol of torture and death, right? It was the symbol of someone being punished for some type of crime. And even whether they did it or not, it was extremely shameful. They were being lifted up for everyone to see. You know, look at this person being punished and dying in such a shameful way. And so when he was preaching the cross, you can imagine everyone in society. Gentile just means those who have a pagan background or those who are not in the line of the Jews, and then of course the Jews as well. And so when the Greeks heard it, they were thinking, why are you telling us about someone who received the death penalty, right? It seemed like foolishness to them. Why are you telling us about that? And then for the Jews as well, even more shocking, which we'll see as a stumbling block for them in a few verses later, but basically Paul was telling them, the Messiah you've been waiting for died on a cross, right? So they would think this is foolishness, that they didn't want to hear it. Sometimes immediately their ears were turned off, they weren't thinking about it anymore, and so that's why they would turn away from that message. And so he says, it sounds like foolishness to those who are perishing, and so they'll go on without hearing or understanding or accepting the good news. But of course, for those who have heard and believed, and he knows that there are many in the Corinthian church, or he's appealing to them, that they have believed this. And so he says, you have experienced their power, right? If you have been saved, you have experienced the power of God, you have accepted the message of the Christ, of Christ dying on the cross for sins. And as he says this, he begins to explain, he really wants to get rid of any pride that they may have, that somehow it was their own thinking, or it's the wisdom of the Greeks, or the wisdom of the Jewish people, or anything like that. In verse 19, he says, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the cleverness of the clever I will set aside. And so, Paul is saying that God is destroying the wisdom of the world, that saving knowledge is only found in Jesus Christ. It's something that is revealed, and so it cannot be reasoned to by the minds of those who are in the world. Now, of course, the Greeks highly prized philosophy. They highly prized all those great thinkers, and especially those who were good at speaking, those who could present various ideas. In verse 20, he says, where is the wise man? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has God not made foolish the wisdom of the world? Not only is worldly wisdom going to end, right? It's just, there's a limit to it. There's only so much you can find out by thinking and reasoning. You need revelation. In verse 20, Paul is saying that the wisdom of the world is temporary. He asks the question, where's the wise man, the scribe, the debater of the age? And the point he's making is that it's all passing away. And as I was studying this and thinking about philosophy, thinking about the sages of time past, we can even ask, where is the wise one of ages past? Do we know what they were teaching? Or usually when we look back, we think, wow, those ideas are strange. Those ideas don't make any sense whatsoever. So their philosophies that were in vogue, we don't even know today. He says, where is the scribe? And this would be someone who was an expert writer, most likely someone who was making great literature, writing down all of their eloquent ideas. And of course, the wisdom, even that's written down, can be lost or forgotten or ignored over time. And then the last one, the debater of the age. This was someone who was a disputer, someone who was very skilled at arguing philosophy, presenting, proving, and defending ideas that were popular of that time. And this was a practice that was popular back then. There would actually be traveling philosophers, traveling teachers. They would gather a crowd, and if they were very persuasive in their speech or they liked their ideas, then they would maybe even become a follower of that philosophy or of that person. But Paul says they all pass away. As time goes on, the wisdom of yesterday is no longer considered the wisdom even of tomorrow. I wrote down here, I said, if we were asking even those who are in here, or maybe even like 99% of people, if we asked, what was the philosophy of 2,000 years ago? What was the philosophy of 200 years ago? What was the philosophy of 20 years ago? Probably no one can answer, because they're just not, we don't remember what they were even teaching. And often when we look back on the, as I mentioned, the wisdom of yesterday, we think, man, those philosophies seem so strange, or why would anyone believe that back then? And so that's what Paul is saying. The wisdom of the world is passing as time goes on. It's no longer seen as wisdom, no longer remembered as wisdom. Something new or something else comes up, even in our society, every decade, as we even have the word for fads, new ideas that, oh, this is a good idea now, and then a decade later, or however long later, man, that was a really strange thing we believed not even too long ago. So he says the passing of the wisdom of the world happens very quickly. In verse 21, he says, for since the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom, did not come to know God, God was well pleased through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. And so this is in God's plan, that at first the message sounds like foolishness, but it's going to take the power of God to enlighten the mind, to open the heart unto belief. Especially more in the next chapter, Paul talks about the Holy Spirit opening the mind, enlightening the mind, giving the revelation so that the message could not only be understood, but believed. And another point that Paul will hit on numerous times after this, the whole reason for this is to give glory to God. It seems as though the message is foolishness, but in the end, it's God's pleasure, as it says here, to save by this message. And so he receives all of the glory, especially when the world says this is unreasonable or they are turned away by it. In the end, those who are being powerfully saved by God, all the glory goes to God and to his wisdom. In verse 22, it says, for indeed the Jews ask for signs and the Greeks search for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block and to the Gentiles foolishness. Now, the Jews were looking for a sign. They wanted supernatural miracles, most likely thinking of the great miracles of Moses or Elijah and Elisha. But the problem was that Jesus had already done many signs, right? He had done miracles right before the religious authorities, right before the Pharisees and the Sadducees and everyone else who wanted evidence, and they still rejected these signs. They even said, and they interpreted them and said, oh, he must be doing this by the power of Satan. I know that Mark has been doing lessons. I think he just completed two parts on Satan, right? So there were miracles being done right before them, but they were even saying, oh, these must be false miracles. They were rejecting his signs. They were reinterpreting them. And ultimately, they were rejecting Jesus as being the Messiah. So they would ask for signs, but they were not being genuine. Jesus had already done signs, the apostles had already done signs, that they should believe the signs that had already been done. We also learn through the Gospels that miraculous signs do not necessarily lead to saving faith. People may be amazed or entertained, but again, they may just want more entertainment, or they may reinterpret them or forget them, and they will not, or they may not come to saving faith. And we have to examine ourselves as well. You know, if we're asking for signs, if we're asking for some kind of evidence, we need to check ourselves and say, are we putting the level of proof so high that it cannot be met? We should believe in the miracles of Jesus Christ, and especially the question of, do you believe the miracles that are in the gospel, the gospels, right? They say, we are eyewitnesses. He did these things. He did many miracles. Peter did miracles. Paul did miracles. And so our investigation needs to be into the Word of God and whether we believe those miracles or not. And so we already have signs as well. I'm just mentioning this because even the Jews of that day, they wanted a sign, and today someone would say, oh, if I saw a miracle, I would believe. Well, the Bible says it may not necessarily lead to belief. We should investigate the miracles that have happened in Scripture. So why wouldn't you believe those? And then the Greeks seek for wisdom. And so again, They loved reasoning. You remember the history of thought. You have Socrates and Plato and Aristotle, all these different philosophical traditions, argumentation and discussions. They wanted to find out what was true, or supposedly they wanted to find what was true about the universe and life and spiritual things. But at the same time, they could be insincere as well. Even as it says in Acts 17, you remember when Paul was speaking at Mars Hill, it said this was their pastime. They would go there to hear something new. They would go there to hear a new idea that they had not heard, and that's what they did all day long. So they could be insincere about even philosophy. They would say, oh, I'm interested intellectually, but then they would say, I have some intellectual problems, but they were not believing. When Paul was at Mars Hill, if you remember at the end of his, near the end of his speech, I think it was actually cut off because people were scoffing when he mentioned that Jesus was resurrected, when he rose from the dead. And the reason they did that was because Plato actually taught that that the body was a prison for the soul. And so they thought the best thing was when somebody died, when the body was no longer alive, the soul would be freed. And that's why they thought the resurrection was intellectually or even theologically ridiculous to them. And so Paul is just making the point. They seek after wisdom. They act like they're looking for something intellectual. When they hear about the cross, when they hear about the resurrection, suddenly they close their minds off and they don't want to believe it. And so it becomes a stumbling block for the Jews. And that word, stumbling block, actually means to be scandalized. So they were tripping over this, as it were, the Messiah being nailed on the cross. And so immediately they would be offended and put off by that message. And then the Greeks would be looking for this wisdom, which they would not find in the foolish message of the cross. So let's look at verse 24. And so he explains, or right before that, the Gentiles found it to be foolishness. The Jews wouldn't listen to it. Verse 24, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God, and Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. And so he appeals to them, and he appeals to us. It takes the calling of God unto salvation, that God calls, God opens the mind, his power is seen in the message, that the world is going to react the same way. This message looks like foolishness, but for those of us who hear it, for those who think, who God opens our minds, opens our hearts, then it is the powerful message unto salvation. So in the cross, there is unity, as Paul is making his point here. And it's open to everyone. As we mentioned before, all these differences there may be in the world, whatever background difference or cultural difference or whatever it is, the cross of Christ is the same message. As Paul said there, he's continuously preaching the cross. And what is that message? If you believe, if you repent, if you trust in Christ, if you trust in his sacrifice for your sins, then your sins are paid for. And there is great unity and equality in spiritual things, which we will see next as well. At this point, are there any questions from those who are here? Any questions on the feed? Give it a few seconds to look those up. I know this is a weighty passage. We're just going through it pretty quickly, but anything on the feed there, Cameron? All right, okay. So the last section, gospel unity in Christ, gospel unity in Christ, verses 26 through 31. Paul is making the point here, all of the spiritual blessings and the benefits that we have in Christ, that we're unified in him. And as we mentioned, one of Paul's favorite phrases, in Christ, he really makes the point here of how we are joined to him. In verse 26, for consider your calling, brothers and sisters, that there were not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to shame the things which are strong. And the insignificant things of the world and the despised, God has chosen the things that are not, so that he may nullify the things that are, so that no human may boast before God. But it is due to him that you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, so that just as it is written, let the one who boasts, boasts in the Lord. So Paul calls them to consider their calling, as he just mentioned, the calling unto salvation, the calling in the gospel. And one of my favorite illustrations here, he says, there are not many wise, there are not many according to the flesh, mighty or noble or all of these different things. But the gospel instead was showing its power, saving many of the lowly who were in society. So those who did not have any type of status or any type of wealth or some type of nobility or strength pretty much anything where the world would say, this person looks like someone who is strong, this person looks like someone who is elite. Instead, the lowly quickly recognized the value of the gospel, that they were constantly searching for good news in their lives. They heard the good news of the cross, and they quickly would come to salvation. And I like this example because, you know, we think even applying it to ourselves, we say, well, how many of us or how many even people in general might have PhDs, be considered part of the elite or the strong or the rich or the powerful or the noble, all of those things. And all throughout history, that would be a very small sliver of any society, right? So the gospel did not come just for those at the very top. As a matter of fact, those who are lowly, those who are looking for good news, often believe it readily. And so it makes the point that God's strength, God's power in the gospel is shown, that even someone who simply believes the gospel can have salvation. And for many of those who are, as I said, seeking after wisdom, seeking after signs, they seem like they are the elite of this world, but a lot of things in their own thinking or a lot of reservations that they have may be shutting them off from considering the gospel even more. And so the weak, the lowly, the despised, all of those God uses to shame those who are mighty, those who think that they're working for their own salvation, those who think they have everything they need in this world. Instead, God's wisdom is power, and power is shown by saving those who simply believe the message of the cross. And the whole point of this is in verse 29, it says that no one may boast. All of these accomplishments and status, later on in Corinthians, he addresses the same thing. Many members in the church were becoming prideful. They were boasting against one another because of their spiritual gifts, the abilities that God had given them. Instead, he says, the whole reason that God does this is to take away this boasting. And a few verses later, he says, we should boast in Christ, which we will look at. And so in gospel unity, it takes away pride. Instead of tearing each other down, we find the wisdom in the gospel, that we build each other up, that we're unified in everything that we have. In verse 30, he talks about the spiritual benefits that we now have in Christ. He gives a wonderful list in verse 30. When we are spiritually joined with Christ, we receive all of these benefits. The first one, it says, is wisdom. Wisdom in verse 30. Now, in Christ is the wisdom of God. We think of this amazing plan, right? Even as it says, before the foundation of the world, God chose us in him. He was making his plan that he would send a Savior, that it would be his Son. Even when Adam fell into sin, the solution, the brilliant, wise solution of God was to send a new head of humanity, to send Jesus Christ. And then the wisdom was found in the incarnation, that how would man and God be reconciled? Well, Jesus Christ would be both fully man and fully God in order to reconcile sinful humanity. And so we have all of these spiritual blessings, the first one being wisdom. All the wisdom of God is found in Christ. Paul writes this in Colossians 2. This is verses 2 and 3 and 8 and 9. He's telling the Colossians to have full assurance of their understanding, resulting in a true knowledge of God's mystery, that is Christ himself. And so even this mystery of Christ was revealed, his wisdom. In whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. In verse 8, this is in Colossians 2, See to it that there is no one who takes you captive through philosophy and empty deception in accordance with human tradition, in accordance with the elementary principles of the world, rather than in accordance with Christ, for in him is all the fullness of deity dwells in bodily form. So especially that line there where it says, don't let anyone take you captive through worldly philosophy. So that's what he has been arguing against from the beginning. So we're looking for the wisdom of God in the cross of Christ and in Christ, not the wisdom of the world. Secondly, in verse 30, there is the righteousness that is found in Christ. And this righteousness means that we are found right before God, that we are in accord with God's standards of holiness. And this is a much larger topic, but the picture is that when we become saved, when we trust in Christ, we receive the righteousness from Christ's account, and our sins go on to the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. So you see the picture of we receive the righteousness of Christ, and our sins are taken away from our account. And Romans 4, the whole chapter, Paul explains this. It's called a justification. So justification is being declared righteous before God. And he says, as soon as you have faith, you are justified before him. You're declared not guilty. You have the righteousness of Christ in your standing before God. And then specifically in 2 Corinthians 5:21, it says, he made him who knew no sin to be sin in our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. And so we just explain that as Christ's substitution on our part. He died the death we should have died. He paid for the sins we should have paid for. And in exchange, we receive the righteousness in Jesus Christ. And again, this is a spiritual blessing. Everyone who believes, everyone who repents, you now have the righteous, you now stand in the righteousness of Christ. You see, the next one there is sanctification. And this is such a wonderful word, means being set apart from the world, set apart from sin in the world, set apart for God, for his purposes, to live a life that is righteous and holy, pursuing those things, so specially set apart for him. And if you look in 1 Corinthians 1, let's just go there for a moment, it's actually verse 2, so just go back up to the beginning of the letter. You'll notice this here with me. So 1 Corinthians 1:2, Paul already used this word before, right as he started the letter. So he says, you're sanctified in Christ. 1 Corinthians 1:2 says, to the church of God, which is at Corinth, to those who have been what? Sanctified in Christ Jesus. Saints by calling, with all who in every place call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord and ours. And so even in his greeting, Paul uses the same word. He tells the Corinthians, if they have believed, you've been set apart. You've been set apart from the world unto God, unto holiness. And then he even goes on, he calls them saints, which means it's the same root there, holy ones, those who have been set apart, those who are in the church. And then even after that, everyone in every place who calls on the name of the Lord. So even 2,000 years later, we've called on the name of the Lord. We'd be considered saints set apart in Jesus Christ as well. Then the last one there, we have redemption. Redemption, and meaning this is the death that Jesus paid the price in death on the cross. He paid the price for our sins. And of course, the picture was often of prisoners or slaves, that there was some type of price that needed to be paid to pay for their freedom. And Jesus paid the price, as we said, for our sins, that we're now free from the penalty of sin, free from the power of sin in our lives. In Jesus' own words, in Mark 10:45, he said, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to what? To give his life as a ransom for many, to pay that price, to pay that ransom, to redeem us. In Ephesians 1:7, it says, in him we have redemption through his blood for the forgiveness of our wrongdoings or our sins according to the riches of his grace. So we are gloriously redeemed in Christ Jesus. As you can tell, this is the basis for our unity. Every single one of us, every Christian who has believed and has turned from sins, this is what Paul is saying. You are in Christ. You are joined to Christ. All of these benefits, these spiritual benefits, are yours. Ephesians 1:3, he says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. And you can notice in that verse, he says in Christ two times, and he says you have been blessed with what? Every spiritual blessing is in him. The last verse brings this point home, that if anyone boasts, we should be boasting in the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no boasting in our own accomplishments, our own strengths, or even as he gave the list there, those who think they're strong, your achievements, your social status, whatever service God may have you be doing in the church or your gifting or whatever it is. No, he says, boast in the Lord. Even back in Jeremiah where it said, those who may boast in their knowledge, boast in their abilities. No, you should be boasting in Jesus Christ. And when the word boast is used this way, it actually means to praise, right? Boasting just means speaking great things. If you're speaking great things about yourself, then you're boasting, you're being prideful. But if you're speaking great things about Christ, then you're actually praising and glorying and pointing others to where they should be looking, not to yourself, but instead to Jesus Christ. And so, as Paul makes his case, when unity is in a crisis, there is gospel unity. There's unity in the cross. Everyone is equal, as you've heard that saying, equal at the foot of the cross, that the same message is for everyone. We're all sinners. We need to hear the good news that our sins have been paid for in the cross. And then we are all unified in Christ. Every spiritual blessing that we just mentioned, available to anyone who believes, anyone who repents, has nothing to do with any of those other background things we mentioned, any of the divisive things that are going on today. It's the same message for all, and the tremendous blessing of being united in Christ as well. And so, of course, this is the message the church continuously needs to hear, the church and every believer, as well as our world today, a message of unity and good news in the gospel message and in Christ. Are there any questions as we wrap up here? We'll check the feed and those who are here in person. Oh, was that mean nothing, Cameron? Yeah. Oh, okay. All right. So glad we could go through this, looking at gospel unity. I think the book of Corinthians has been on my heart, and as you can tell, it's very weighty. Paul is making quite a case in the Corinthian church, showing them a picture of what they need for unity. And so let's go ahead and pray, and we'll thank God for our study tonight. Heavenly Father, we highly regard your word. We thank you, God, for the writing and the teaching of Paul, your servant that you used in this way. And even in this church, even in Corinth that had all these problems, you used Paul to write such a message like this one, to point out unity in their lives, unity in the congregation, unity between believers. We get to see all of these benefits that it's all by your grace that we're saved. It's all by your grace, the plan of salvation, whatever place you put us, whatever gifts you give us, whatever background we come from, if we trust and if we turn from our sins, we have the same salvation and the same glorious connection in Jesus Christ. We thank you, God, for this, and even as this is such an important message for us today, we hope that we continue to live this as a testimony in our own church, in our own lives, and even if there's an opportunity to share the gospel with others and to share that message of unity with all the division that is happening today. We thank you, God, that you have chosen the weak. You have chosen those who are lowly, that just by the simple belief in the gospel, eternal salvation is ours. And we continue to pray that that is the message of the cross, the message of Christ that goes out from here. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, well, thank you everyone for joining us, both near and far. Go ahead and, again, leave a comment or even contact us about prayer requests or Bible studies or anything like that, and we would love to get back to you. And we hope to see you all on Sunday or whatever study you can make before then.